Third year,
yeah.
Yeah, say you're a third year.
Yeah, something like
you're
that.
You're a third year student here at SSU. Yeah, we'll get going here. Jared's going to share a little bit about his life. He's saying it's, you know, like you come here together and you kind of get to know each other where you're at, but not always do you know what the different kinds of experiences someone has been through before they've arrived here, these experiences here together. So he's gonna share a little bit about that, and I'll, you know, maybe plug away some questions out of him along the way. And I think he wants you to feel free as well to ask him questions along the way as he's talking. So just like throw your hand up, or if you really need to interrupt him, I guess you can interrupt him. But yeah, so here we are.
Yes.
Excuse me, Jared. So Jared, okay. One thing that most people who just met you won't know is that your family has had like some opportunities to like live abroad, right?
Yeah, my parents were international teachers. So I was born in Taiwan, lived there till I was 2, and then moved to Beirut, where I lived till I was 10, and then we moved here.
So, when you were born in Taiwan, would that make you Taiwanese?
No. To be Taiwanese, your father has to be Taiwanese. Okay. My father was born and raised in Dartmouth.
It's a little different. Okay, cool. So you have this Craig, she's still.
You want to get into the conversation.
Yeah, you should have answered your
question. Don't you ever get into the question.
Come on back.
No. If he calls back, I will do it. That would be awesome. There's a chance that he might. Okay, so you've had this international experience, so it means like you're kind of used to being in different places.
Yeah, well, because Lebanon's so close to a lot of really cool places, and then we got Muslim and Christian holidays, so it allowed for like a lot of time to travel. Yeah, traveling was just a normal part of my life that I took for granted until I moved to Canada and stopped traveling. So yeah, that's pretty cool.
And there's, like, from those experiences, there's one experience in particular that you wanted to talk about and share. And I don't know if I can do a good job of introducing it, so you might as well just, like, dive right in.
Alright, so basically what I want to talk about is in grade 3, my family took a trip to Sri Lanka over Christmas break. And we ended up, like, there was a huge tsunami there, and like we ended up actually like seeing it and like being really close to it. And so that's kind of the story that I want to tell in detail today. So that, yeah, it was a really big thing for my family and still is. And so yeah, I just want to share it so you guys know a little bit more about me. Mm-hmm. Is it cool if I just start the story?
Story time!
Yeah,
story
time.
So, we went to Sri Lanka, which is like off the coast of India. It's a little island. And we had been in the mountains. We were on a 2-week trip, and we had been in the mountain area for the first week. And I was so excited to go down to the beaches. So we get to the beach area, and this is now Christmas Day, and we find this hotel, and the hotel had white sand beaches with palm trees and hammocks. They had an in-ground pool with fresh water, and like it was just like the ideal like place. And yeah, our driver at the time, who barely spoke any English and barely said a word to us the entire time, he just said, this place doesn't even feel right. And he said that it didn't feel right and that he wanted us to move to a different spot. And our family was like, are you crazy? Like, we loved that spot. And so we ended up moving up to a higher ground.
And your driver, was this like a driver that you had kind of for
Yeah, we had him for the 2 weeks because we were like doing like the whole country.
It wasn't like a taxi driver that like just dropped you off and like this doesn't feel right. It was like
he was part of our trip for the whole trip.
Yeah, interesting.
And so we ended up moving to a spot that was a bit higher. And so cut to Boxing Day the next day. We get up at about 4 a.m. and we're gonna make our trip down the mountain and go to this safari park. On our way down, there was about 6 elephants, 3 giraffes, and just a bunch of other like big animals. And they were all walking away from the park. And I remember the driver saying, like, this is crazy because they know that they're safe in the park and they never leave the park. We had all these animals were leaving the park. And so we start a safari. There's honestly not a whole lot there. There's a couple crocodiles and flamingos or whatever. And we get to this one part and there's just a dried up riverbed. It's probably about from me to the stairs. And there's no water in it and it's all dry. And we cut across it. And we went and we continued our park, still not seeing a whole lot of anything really. And we stopped at this beautiful giant tree for lunch that day. And so we're on our way back because we're not seeing a whole lot. And the river that we had cut through that was dry was now filling very fast. So we rush through it, and by the time we get to the other side, it's almost full. And by the time we're not even maybe 50 meters away or whatever, and it actually starts to like overflow the river. And so the driver says, oh, a dam just broke. The dam just broke. It's nothing. Okay, whatever, a dam just broke. And then, I remember my mom, she said, what's that? And we all look behind us, and there's just this gray, fuzzy, like, line wall type thing. And then something fell out of it. And our driver's like, yeah, that's a water buffalo. And so we didn't know what, like, it was too far away for us to like actually know that it was the tsunami coming in. But it was. And we rushed out of there. And we had to switch drivers at the gate because we were in a park jeep, and so we had to switch to our van that we were in for the trip. And I remember that happening very fast, and they wanted us gone. And so we come up the mountain a bit, and everybody coming down, the police are turning away. And so the driver, who doesn't speak any English again, he was trying to tell us, like, the dam that broke, he's like, they're turning because of the dam that broke. Mm-hmm. And my dad's like, that's ridiculous. He's like, this is the dam that broke, like, they don't need to turn around. And then he's told us that the dam had hit, it had hit Indonesia. And so, we still didn't quite get it at the time, like, we didn't know how a dam breaking could affect another place. But we get up to, we get back up to our hotel, and the TV was on, and because it's just happened, and there's no, like, there's no graphic sensors or whatever for their news over there, and so they were just showing the whole thing, and there was bodies everywhere, buses floating, bodies, boards, buildings were floating. And I still remember that exact moment. It was pretty surreal to, like, even like as a grade 3 kid, and then realizing, like, at that moment, this is where we were this morning. This is what we saw. And if we had spent probably 5 more minutes at that tree that I was talking to you about having lunch, or 5 or 10 more minutes looking at a crocodile or something, it is very likely that my whole family would not be here today. And one of the craziest parts to my family is that the driver that I, like, at the, when it started the story, I was saying that the driver didn't like the place we were at. And that place was completely wiped out. So when we ran back to our hotel and grabbed all our stuff and left, had we also been heading to that place, it is also very likely that we wouldn't be here. And yeah, I think I can't remember who it was, but one of the members of our, he couldn't continue the trip with us, which is reasonable. But the whole experience of about 5 hours is still very, very much affects everyone in our family. And it affects the course that me and my brothers, it affects what we want to do for the, like, the rest of our lives. And yeah, I think it was such a surreal experience. And I don't think that I've fully processed it. I know I haven't fully processed it. I don't think that I ever will fully process it. And I can't say for 100%, but I'm pretty sure the rest of my family feels the same way. And yeah, I'm not a religious person at all, but I do know that God is real and watching me, and that right there is why. And the fact that my family is still here, and the fact that I'm still here, and that I get the chance to still live my life, it's very clear to my whole family that God had his hand on the 5 of us on that day. Mm-hmm. and that so many people died. And the white tourists, they lived to tell their story. And that's sorry. Yeah, that's my story.
Yeah. So one of the big reasons why you wanted to share that story specifically is because it really sounds like it's a huge part of who you are, and probably even, you know, to some degree why you're here at SSU, or why you're taking the courses that you take, or you have the interests that you do, and all that, like you were saying with you and your brother, how it's shaped your guys' lives. So, what are some of your thoughts on that, like, for you personally? It's like, you can't process it, but you can do something with what you have, so what do you do?
Yeah, I've kind of come to this school to do the Bachelor of International Studies and get a medics course while doing such, and hopefully end up working for a disaster relief agency somewhere in the world, and helping or giving medical aid to people who have just been through something like that. And yeah, that's what I wanted to do. Yeah, it's hard to say like 100%, but it stems from that.
Yeah.
Definitely. And my brother is going into nursing. And I think he wants to eventually get in some kind of international work with it. Yeah, my parents still keep updated on some of the charities that they still donate to that are still working. I mean, I can't say for this year, but as of last year, that hotel that we wanted to stay at, that our driver didn't like, was still underwater. And on the map, like, it actually has moved the coastline and changed their map. And the whole town, like, whole coastal town's just gone. Without warning. And they say that it took about 2 hours to get in from wherever the earthquake happened in the ocean. It took 2 hours for the wave to come. And yet nobody knew about it until it was there.
Yeah.
So that's pretty sad. I think. That a whole tsunami can just go for 2 hours without warning.
Greg, can I add a little SSU piece to that story?
Yep.
So in February of 2005, the Asia trip went over there, and I was part of the trip. And we landed in Penang, and so the event that you're talking about was Boxing Day 2004.
Yeah.
Right? And so a group of us landed there. We were right by a bay that basically, when the tsunami hit that bay, first all the water was sucked out, and then there were about 40 people that didn't get off out of the way of it, that were just killed by the incoming wave. And people everywhere in Asia, everywhere we went, they were talking about the tsunami. People had lost family members, people had lost villages. The first day that we were there, we actually visited a Sri Lankan church in Penang. Penang is very multicultural. So we attended that service, and the people there were talking about what you're sharing right now with the same kind of feeling that you're speaking of, you know, that close. Thank you.
The conversation about travel, I think in general, because I know your years traveling and living abroad with your family have impacted your desire to care for the world and see more of the world. And I also know from being in Asia that there were different experiences that brought you back to times like in Lebanon, reminding you of growing up. And I know you've had the Europe trip as well, and I just wonder, I mean, this question could go lots of different directions, I guess, but I'm just interested to hear more about how, as you've traveled with SSU, it's continued to impact the way you want to live in the world, or maybe, looking back, has it helped you process some of those experiences that you've had, good and bad, maybe just the idea of those 10 years of your life living abroad, has traveling with SSU kind of helped you think about that in a different way?
I think so. I don't know if I can put into words exactly how it has changed. But yeah, there's definitely been some moments where I've just been taken back on both SSU trips, and yeah, has just made me realize that not everybody gets to have had some of the experience that I have had. But also realizing that some people have. And I think that's, especially when we went to Laos, and that was like other people have lived it. And so yeah, I think that was more realizing that other people have. And a lot of people that I talk to in Canada, they haven't seen war or know what it was like. Mm-hmm. But in Laos, that's all they talk about. And there was so much of it. And it's like, okay, well, maybe I was in Lebanon when they were in conflict, but I wasn't in Laos during the secret war. I don't know where I was going with that, but it connects somehow. It all connects somehow.
That's really interesting that it's made me think of is how do we respond as in times of major disasters like this, and And then, you know, how do people know about it and what kind of media coverage happens and that kind of stuff. And how it can be so localized and like we have access to like, so much information now. And I'm sure even the systems, I'm sure since the tsunami, they've developed more systems to track, earthquakes and but just reflecting on some of these major disasters that we're not, you know, you kind of alluded to, we're not necessarily used to it here in some contexts, you know, like maybe we have our own kind of like forest fires that have been in BC, you know, this summer, but when all the massive flooding was happening this summer, you know, down in Texas and then and so many other places in the world, you know, it's, you know, sometimes we feel pretty helpless in how to respond.
I was just going to say, I was glad, Jeremy, that you mentioned, like, what the state was as recently as last year, and just keeping in mind that with that, we hear all the headlines, and then because we're not in it, we forget about it.
Yeah.
But it affects a lot of lives and families for years and years and years to come.
Yeah. Yeah, we're able to kind of carry on with our lives. And in one sense, you know, that's what you're alluding to with, you know, all the white tourists are able to, like, just go home.
Yeah.
But your family's still wrestling with that experience.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's others that were there that are wrestling with it too.
And
so there's a difference between like actually being there and now having to carry that with you versus us just seeing a headline, you know, or versus just seeing a headline, right? And being affected by it, you know, you feel the tragedy or you sympathize it, but it's not in your immediate life. So there's a crazy tension there. Well, I really want to thank you for sharing. And I think it's important that, you know, we continue to share these different stories of ourselves, and you know, it doesn't have to be all neatly wrapped up and figured out. And it'll be really cool just to see how you continue to walk on that journey of how this has impacted you.
Mm-hmm.
And we're here with you, I guess. Thanks. Yeah. Do you want to say anything else? You
sorry that it's a bit short, but you all know a little bit more about me now.
No worries. Cool. Well, thanks for coming. And I think I'll just put in a little plug for next week because I think it's confirmed that we have another world traveler actually coming and speaking. Alumni Stephen Barker is actually going to drop in. He's just, he graduated 2 years ago now. And he spent, most of that 2 years in South Korea teaching English. And he's a cool dude, interesting fellow, and I'm sure he's going to have some interesting experiences to share. We'll see what he has to say. It's always, you never know. So anyway, stay tuned and come on next week.
Thanks. Thanks, Jeremy.